At the end of the last video, we had briefly discussed using the periodic table to determine what the electron configuration is for a particular element. We labeled the different blocks, the S, P, D, and F block, and we discussed why they were labeled this way. S can hold 2 electrons, so there's 2 elements. P can hold 6 electrons, so there are 6 elements. D can hold 10, so there are 10, and F can hold 14, so there are 14 elements. The S and the P blocks match perfectly with the row or the period of the table that the element is in, and our D blocks are off by 1, so 3D is in row 4, and F blocks are off by 2, 4F is in row 6. We've already gone over carbon's configuration, but let's kind of talk about using the periodic table. So you see carbon here, and when you look at it in this labeled table here, you should notice that carbon is the second element in the P block. When we go ahead and we go through and use our periodic table to assist us in writing a configuration, what we do instead is we always want to start at the very beginning of the periodic table, so the H. So we're going to follow the hierarchy from H all the way down to carbon. So H is 1s, and then it's 1s1 here, which becomes 1s2 over here because of the helium. Then we have our 2s, and both of those electrons are present, so it's 2s2, followed by our 2p, but carbon is the second element, therefore it only ends in 2p2. The numbers that we previously discussed were the maximum values that each orbital could hold. So S can hold a maximum of 2, P can hold a maximum of 6, D can hold a max of 10, and F can hold a max of 14. So carbon's configuration was 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. Iron is all the way down here. So we know that it's going to end in 3D because it's part of the 3D block. Once again, we're going to start up top. We're going to work our way across. So we have 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, and then since it is the sixth element in the D block, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, its configuration would end as 3D6. So if I write this whole thing, it looks like this. And to double check yourself, you can always add up the superscripts here, and when you add those superscripts together, you should end up with the atomic number. When we add all of those together, we get 26, which is iron's atomic number. At this time, please pause the video and attempt the additional 3 practice problems. As you can see, the remaining answers have now been provided. Sulfur is going to end in 3p, and it's the fourth element, so it's going to end in a 3p4. Strontium ends in 5s, it's in the fifth row, second element in the S block, so it's 5s2 for the end of its configuration. And titanium is in the 4d block, and it's the fifth element over, so it ends in 4d. The most common mistake seen on these is right here with the D block. You have to remember that after 4s is 3d, not 4d, and after 5s is 4d, not 5d. There's additional practice on the website on configurations. Let's turn or kind of switch gears a little bit. The rest of this chapter is about the periodic table. We are going to review periodic history, talk about some basic knowledge, as well as periodic trends. Let's first discuss the development of the periodic table. In the early 1800s, Dobereiner proposed the idea of triads. At this time, there were only about 20 to 30 elements discovered, so most of the table was still undiscovered. But he recognized that when you put elements into groups of three, they shared similar properties. For example, lithium, sodium, and potassium. If you take the atomic mass of lithium and the atomic mass of potassium, and you find its average when you add those together and divide by 2, you end up getting a very close number to that of sodium. Some years go by, more elements have been discovered, and J.R. Newlands in 1865 proposed the law of octaves. He said that when elements are arranged by increasing atomic mass, a pattern exists every eighth element. His big mistake was making the connection between science and music or an art. Even though he was very similar to what the next scientist did, he is not given anywhere near as much credit because of this connection with science and art. A few years later, Dmitri Mendeleev, who has become known as the father of the periodic table, again arranged elements by increasing atomic mass and saw patterns in groups of eight. So just like Newlands. His one major contribution was that he left some space on the table for elements that he knew he was missing. So again, more elements are being discovered. The periodic table is being used at this point. It's almost correct. Years have gone by, and Moseley, in 1914, rearranged the elements just a little bit. He proposed the idea of periodic law. And instead of increasing atomic mass, he said the elements should be arranged by increasing atomic number. And when they are arranged by increasing atomic number, the element's physical and chemical properties show what is known as a periodic pattern, which we are going to be discussing shortly. So these are some of the key people that played a major role in the development of the periodic table. They make great multiple choice questions for tests. Here's some additional information on the periodic table. Again, most of this should be review. You need to make sure you know where the metals are, where the nonmetals are, and where the metalloids or the semi-metals are. If it is helpful, you actually can draw in a little stair step on your periodic table, and that line helps separate the metals and the nonmetals, except for hydrogen. The rows of the periodic table are called periods. There are 7 of them. The groups, or the columns, or the families, exist as well, and there are 18 of them. The table is composed of a variety of metals, nonmetals, and semi-metals, and it's arranged by increasing atomic number, which we said on the previous slide was periodic law. And the properties of the elements can change in a predictable way, and these are called periodic trends. As you can see, I have labeled some general properties about metals, nonmetals, and semi-metals. Metals have a luster, which means they are shiny, they're usually solid, and they can conduct electricity. Nonmetals are the opposite, so they're dull, they're usually gases, and they do not conduct. Your semi-metals in the middle of the table have properties of both metals and nonmetals, and they're often used in electronics. Again, great multiple choice questions for tests. In addition to metals, nonmetals, and semi-metals, there are also groups of the periodic table or periodic families. Group 1A, the first column, is known as the alkali metals. Group 2A, right here, your second column, are the alkaline earth metals. So you need to know that one and that one. The middle of the table, the D block right here, are called the transition metals. Over here, group 7A, where fluorine is, are the halogens. And then, of course, group 8A are your noble gases. The bottom of the table are your lanthanides and actinides, which are also referred to as your inner transition metals. Again, a good sample test question might be, which of the following is an alkaline earth metal? And you would pick one of the ones that were in that column. Next, we are going to discuss a variety of periodic trends. At this point, you may want to pause the video for a few moments so that you can copy down the notes that are associated with our periodic trends. Okay, let's discuss. So valence electrons are the electrons in your outermost shell. As you travel across the table, they increase. For groups 1A through 8A, they are going to be equal to your group number. For example, nitrogen is found in group 5A or group 15, and therefore it has 5 valence electrons. These are based on their electron configurations. Another trend is atomic radius. It's the distance from the center of the nucleus and outermost electron, so basically the size of the atom. And as you travel across the table, this decreases. As you travel down the table, this increases. Let's talk about why. As you go across the table, there are more protons in the nucleus, but you're in the same energy level. Those protons have more control, so they can pull their electrons in closer. When you go down the table, there's now an extra energy shell or extra ring. Therefore, there's more shielding away from the nucleus, so the electrons are harder to control, so they're more likely to spread out. For ionization energy, the energy required to remove an electron is the definition. It is the exact opposite trend of atomic radius, but for the same exact reasons. So it increases across and decreases down. There's more protons, more control, so the electrons are harder to remove. As you go down, decreases because there's more shielding, which means less control from the nucleus, and therefore they are easier to remove. Valence electrons and electron configurations. The highest energy level in the configuration is the valence shell, and it can be used to determine the number of valence electrons. So for sodium, it has 1 valence electron, because its configuration is this. Highest energy level, 1 valence electron. Titanium, on the other hand, has a total of 2 valence electrons because its configuration is this. The highest energy level here is 4, and therefore it has 2 valence electrons. We will actually practice this in a future video. This is the last slide for this particular topic. What I would like you to do is pause the video and attempt to answer these questions. Mn is a transition metal, so it has 2 valence electrons. Te is in group 6a, so it has 6. Helium is unique because it is in group 8a, but it only has a total of 2 valence electrons. We'll cover that more later on. For size, When you travel down the table, you increase. When you go across the table, you decrease. And then for ionization energy, it is the opposite.